So let me introduce the Professor John Rogers. He is a Louis Simpson and Kimberly Pore, the professor of material science and engineering, the biomedical engineering and neurological surgery. He received a PhD degree in physical chemistry at MIT in 1995. Then he spent 13 years on the faculty at University of Illinois, most recently as the Swan Lund, the chair, the professor. In 2016, he joined the faculty at Northwestern University to become the director of the newly endowed Corey Simpson Institute for Bioelectronics. He has published more than 750 papers and 100 patents, then also co-founded several successful technology companies. Professor Rogers served as an associate editor at the proceeding of the National Academy of Science, a deputy editor at Science Advance, and co-editors-in-chief at Extreme, the Mechanics Letters. His H index is 179, total citation is 130,000. Please welcome the Professor John Rogers.
Great, thank you very much for that introduction, and thank you for the invitation to take part in this really exciting symposium. It's a real honor to be able to speak with Yunnan and before me and Jeanan after me. I've known both of those folks for a very long time, and I have a tremendous amount of respect for each one of them, and I really enjoyed Yunnan's talk, looking forward to Jeanan's talk. So I'm going to kind of get wedged in between them and talk to you about some of the things that we've been doing in my group, in particular sort of the interface between material science and engineering and medicine. My own expertise, obviously, is sort of material science, but I'm also very interested in engineering, materials technologies, and interdisciplinary work that involves, you know, many traditional fields of engineering intersecting very strongly with medicine. And it's really that appointment, you know, in neurological surgery and my engagements with other departments allow us to do things in this space. So I'll kind of focus on advanced systems and supporting materials for devices designed to adopt skin-like physical characteristics, to integrate with the human body, to provide medically relevant sort of ICU-grade tracking of vital signs and physiological status, both from the level of sort of physical measurements of body processes, but also more recently in biochemical analysis strategies based on sweat. And so at the beginning of the talk, I'll just provide a little bit of a background motivation, give you a sense of the kinds of materials approaches that have worked pretty well for us, but then kind of focus on system level implementations of these ideas and advanced materials and platforms that are really poised to have, I think a positive impact on how we think about healthcare delivery, cost effectiveness, improved outcomes for patients, and in adjacent areas as well, such as sports, athletics, and fitness. And I'll give you a sense of what that kind of looks like. But our overarching goal is to develop the foundations, the materials foundations for classes of microsystems technologies. And that could be electronics, optoelectronics, microelectromechanical systems, microfluidic systems, photonics, this kind of thing. That adopt materials characteristics, physical forms, properties that allow for long-term intimate integration with the human body. That's the ultimate goal. And you might think about integrating electronics with the brain, for example, to understand how the brain operates, or maybe to deliver electrical stimulation to the brain to eliminate various disorders associated with adverse function of the brain. But if you could do that, you would think about other vital organs as well, such as the heart. We've done work with membranes that sort of surround the outside surface of the heart, provide some electrical mapping capabilities, electrical stimulation, stresses, strains, and so on, with the idea of augmenting cardiac health way beyond what's possible with a defibrillator or a simple cardiac pacemaker, all sort of enabled by new ideas in material science. But other areas as well, the kidneys, the bladder, the spinal cord, the peripheral nervous systems, all various parts of the body that we've looked at and have active programs in. I'll focus today on the body's largest organ, which is the skin, and how one can begin to develop technology platforms that can kind of intimately and imperceptibly integrate with the skin to establish a persistent physical interface that can be used for measurements of underlying body processes with sort of clinical or medical grade precision, far beyond what's possible with a conventional wearable that loosely couples to the wrist or the finger, to derive information that physicians can actually act upon and use to improve the ability for them to deliver care to individuals. But if you want to do any kind of biointegration, whether it's the skin or the heart or the brain or other points of the body, or maybe developing a research tool for facilitating animal model studies of underlying principles in biology, it's useful to think about the basic engineering features that you see in the living world. And it's quite daunting to really think about creating man-made systems that embody this level of sophistication. And so that's not necessarily the goal, but to kind of take a step back and think about how biology does things and to see whether certain aspects could be abstracted and embedded into artificial systems. And if you look at biology, it spans an incredibly wide range of length scales, all the way from active actin-based motors that have molecular dimensions, all the way up to muscles that have sort of centimeter, meter scale dimensions. These are 3D systems that integrate hard materials and soft materials. There's electronic functionality, ionic, there are fluid flows, it's responsive, it's multi-component, it's reconfigurable, and so on. And so it's useful as a material scientist to kind of think in general about those approaches and begin to try to pull out certain key features and begin to embed them in microsystem technologies. And that's kind of been the primary motivation for how we've organized the various activities that we have in this broader space from the standpoint of materials and advanced materials technologies. And these are kind of three thrusts that are active in the group in that broader context. The first one of which is to develop electronics, again, man-made microsystems technologies that adopt skin-like characteristics, not only for integration on the skin itself, but those same kinds of ideas can be deployed in brain interface devices or devices that wrap the epicardium or, encircle peripheral nerves, for example. So the question is, how do you create skin-like devices that offer high performance functionality, not only in the supporting electronics and the wireless communication capabilities, the power supply, but also the biosensors themselves? How do you begin to do that? What kinds of materials are best for achieving that goal? And how do you put them all together, in systems that work at a robust, reliable, practical level, so they can be potentially deployed on actual patients. Another area is a little bit different, where we're thinking not so much about mechanics and physical form, but actual materials choices that allow one to build electronics that can bioresorb and disappear naturally over programmed timescales within the body. And so think about resorbable sutures for closing a wound, but now those sutures fully instrumented with sophisticated classes of electronics and wireless communication capability and biosensors and so on. How do you begin to do that? Can you find materials that support high performance, electronic functionality, but at the same time are biodegradable to biocompatible end products? And that's an area that we've been thinking about and working in for about a decade. We know pretty much what we want to do there, and the opportunities are beginning to come in focus now. And then the third one is a little bit more exploratory, where we're trying to develop microsystems and electronics that adopt open mesh 3D type architectures, maybe reminiscent of neural networks in the brain or vasculature trees that you would see in the heart, or at the cellular scale level, cytoskeleton type filamentary designs. How do you begin to create man-made structures that can interact with biology, not just on surfaces, but through 3D volumetric spaces? So that kind of sets the stage for the broader portfolio of activities that we have in this area of sort of materials for biointegrated systems. I'm just going to focus on skin interfaced devices for this presentation. And so the goal with all of this is to achieve devices of those types, but with function that can sort of match the very most sophisticated silicon integrated circuits that are available for consumer electronics gadgetry. And that may seem like a daunting goal, but if you can achieve that, then you can enable really powerful levels of functionality and longevity in operation that will ultimately be needed for many of the classes of bio-integrated applications that we envision for the future. And so you'd want to be able to do that, but in a radically reformulated way that doesn't look anything like a planar, silicon wafer type technology where chips become the building blocks for electronic gadgetry and geometries and with mechanical properties and with materials that are inherently incompatible with the soft textured moving surfaces and volumes that you see in biology. And so there would be kind of two directions you could contemplate then. One is reinventing electronics with fundamentally new materials, move away from silicon to graphene or carbon nanotubes, polymers, and so on. I think that's a really attractive way to think about achieving some of these goals. And we certainly have programs in that direction. The other would be to think about how to deploy inorganic materials like silicon, but in non-wafer formats, in particular, take advantage of sort of nanoscale mechanics to allow silicon to be deployed in these biocompatible formats so that, you could at least envision supporting, electronic functionality that's comparable to a wafer-based system, but in a biocompatible type of platform. And that's really the strategy that I'll introduce to you today or describe to you today, because it's provided the most legs in terms of allowing us to push forward with higher level, integrated systems with practical levels of functionality. And so this talk is not really focused on the foundational materials ideas, because I feel like we and others in the community sort of worked these out in the past, and I don't want to belabor them, but really just focus on what you do with these kinds of ideas. And they're fairly simple, the first of which is to recognize that silicon wafer is rigid and brittle, partly because the silicon, its intrinsic mechanical properties are such, but also because the wafer itself is fairly thick. It's, a millimeter in thickness. And if you make any material sufficiently thin, it becomes bendable because the bending stiffness, the flexural rigidity is decreasing like the cube of the thickness. And so we spent a lot of time figuring out how to take silicon wafers, gallium arsenide wafers, gallium nitride, indium phosphide, and you apply a sort of anisotropic chemical etching techniques to allow us to shave off the near surfaces of those wafers to create ribbons and wires and membranes and plates of these materials without altering their intrinsic electronic properties, but rendering them in geometries that afford this kind of mechanical flexibility that you would ultimately need in order to do this kind of biointegration, recognizing that biological surfaces are not rigid and planar, they're curved and dynamic and soft. And so that's kind of idea number one, is create nanoscale forms of these high-performance inorganic semiconductors as building blocks for circuits that can adopt similar types of mechanics. But ultimately, for biointegration, you need something more than just flexibility. You need something that can stretch more like a rubber band. And so you have to come up with a second idea in order to achieve a sort of a stretchable form of silicon. But even that, it turns out to be really easy. You take these thin silicon strips, you bond them to an underlying elastomer substrate, but you bond them with the elastomer in a slightly pre-stretched state, such that when you relax that pre-stretch, after doing that bonding step, a buckling instability creates a wavy geometry in the hard material, the silicon ribbons in this case. And that yields a hard soft composite material whose effective mechanics are dominated by the underlying elastomer, with ranges of stretchability that exceed by orders of magnitude the intrinsic stretchability of the silicon, because you're balancing in-plane deformations for out-of-plane displacement, much like an accordion bellows. That's kind of the flavor of the underlying physics. But if you take those two basic ideas and you add all sorts of engineering elaborations on top of them, add other classes of materials, you can begin to realize this vision of skin-like high-performance electronics. I'm not going to go through the details because it's sort of belabored in great length in a number of papers that we and others in the community have published. And I felt like we kind of had a handle on how to do things in 2011, got a little bit better in 2014. And ever since that time, we really focused on answering the question is, what is this good for? Now you can do all of these things. What are the unmet clinical needs that could be addressed with this novel form of technology, sort of enabled by this underlying, set of advances in material science and mechanics? And in all of these things, you really think about these devices almost as hybrid, hard, soft, deterministic composites from the vision and the lens of a material scientist in order to get the composites to offer the right set of properties for doing this biointegration, you really need quantitative understanding of the mechanics of how these hard and soft materials interface with one another and how they respond to sort of global strains associated with bending or stretching or all the kinds of deformations that they're likely to undergo once they're integrated with a moving, living biological system. And so we do a lot of this work in close collaborations with theoretical mechanicians, Yonggang Huang here at Northwestern, to understand all of these very important details so that we can embed these computational results as key design tools for determining the details of how you lay out these various materials and integrate them all together such that the deformation doesn't have any adverse consequence on the overall function of the system, and you avoid sort of materials level failure in the form of fractures and so on by minimizing the maximum materials level strain that you see throughout a range of deformations that you expect to encounter in an actual biointegrated application. So that's the materials, that's the mechanics. You have to think about interfaces as well. And if you want to sit on the surface of the skin and you want to use the skin as a window for measuring underlying body processes, you really need geometric conformality. You need perfect aerial contact, or as perfect as you can get, to reduce the impedances associated with the measurement interface. And that kind of filamentary geometry and this kind of buckling mechanics actually facilitates that geometric matching, as well as the kind of soft mechanics that you ultimately need. And so this is a colorized SEM of one of these filamentary network mesh type pieces of electronics resting on a polymer replica of human skin. And you can kind of see how these systems can deform and sort of follow the complex contours of the skin without much of a problem. And that leads to low impedance measurement interface and also a robust mechanical coupling as well that helps to avoid unwanted delamination of these devices off of the skin. So if you can do all that, you can begin to make measurements in a kind of wearables technology, but one that goes far beyond anything that's possible with a conventional wrist-mounted device, because you have this intimate skin interface. And so you can begin to do a lot of things that are commonly done in a hospital setting, but now you can do them continuously in the home. So you can do ECG measurements, for example. You place these devices on the chest. You get not only heart rate and heart rate variability, but you also get the full ECG waveform, which is what the cardiologists really want to see if they want to assess your cardiovascular health. There are a lot of skin disorders associated with extreme dryness of the skin. Now you can do hydration measurements without a handheld corneometer in the form of a skin interface tattoo-like device that can continuously track the water content in the surface at the surface of the skin and measure the response of the skin to medically prescribed moisturizers, for example. Very easy to do that. You can also embed piezoelectric materials in these platforms, allowing for pressure measurements, so you can actually capture the pulse wave dynamics associated with pulsatile blood flow through near surface veins and arteries. And that's also sort of a standard measurement that occurs in a hospital setting to determine arterial health. So you can do all these things. There's actually a very long list. Many groups have published really innovative and creative ideas around new materials for sensors that can sort of drop into these sorts of skin interface platforms, all sorts of precision measurements of thermal characteristics, electrical. I'll come back to fluidic in a little bit in terms of sweat analytics, but mechanical, optical, even mechanoacoustic, so you can measure body sounds, cardiac oscillation, and so on. There's tremendous richness and depth in the kinds of sensors that you can envision, and new sensors are being developed by the broader community all the time. So the toolbox is growing very quickly. And now you can really think about bringing these technologies to bear on really daunting, challenging, unmet needs in clinical healthcare and healthcare more generally speaking. And I'll focus on one. We have many active activities. This was actually our first focus area, which was to address needs of probably the most fragile patient, maybe the most precious patients that you'll come across in a hospital environment. And those are premature babies. So these are babies that are born maybe at 26 weeks, gestational age, 30, 24, in that range. They go straight into intensive care units designed for these patients, known as neonatal intensive care units, NICUs, where they need to be monitored 24/7. Full clinical quality vital signs need to be captured at all times because these patients are in a very fragile health status. And if anything goes wrong, the nurses need to be able to engage immediately. And so they have alarms and other things that will alert them if there's a health crisis associated with these patients. But the problem is that the technology is old, it's antiquated, it's outdated, it's really no good in many ways. It involves rigid biosensors connected via hardwired connections to external boxes of data acquisition electronics, where the biosensors themselves are adhered to the skin with tapes. And this is problematic because the tapes need to be strong enough to hold the sensors on the skin surface in the presence of forces that are inevitably imparted to that interface through the wires due to motions of the babies. But at the same time, the skin of these babies is highly underdeveloped. It's almost not like skin. It's almost like an open wound. It's almost like paste. And so you have to apply these tapes. You have to take the sensors off when you change the diaper, you care for the baby. And in many cases, that peel back process can peel the skin with it. And so lifetime scarring events are not uncommon for premature babies who have to spend significant time in the neonatal intensive care unit. The other thing is that wires sort of frustrate natural motions of the baby, and they also prevent parents from interacting with their child as frequently as they might like to because the wires get in the way. And so this was 5 years ago. We decided, if we could really make this skin-like electronics work and we had all the material science foundations in place, then we'd really like to get rid of these wires and tapes and hard biosensors and replace them with two or three of these stickers operating in a wireless mode to provide the same kind of data quality, but without all the disadvantages of this old technology. And so that turned out to work, and I won't go through the details. It's a tremendous amount of engineering science has to be brought to bear to make this work. But it's basically two of these epidermal or skin-like devices. One goes on the chest, the other goes on a limb, either the hand or the foot. And with those two devices operating in a battery-free, wireless manner, you capture all vital signs and all wires can go away. And so we're able to show that this is a device that goes on the chest. You can capture ECG. In all of the studies that we've done at Lurie Children's Hospital, we've had the wired devices in place as well, so we can do a quantitative one-to-one comparison of our wireless epidermal devices to the conventional clinical standard. And you can see you get a nice matchup in terms of the shapes of the ECG waveforms. And from this, you get the heart rate variability from the amplitude modulations associated with this RP. You can get the respiration rate. There's a clinical grade temperature sensor embedded in this platform as well. And so you can get kind of a surrogate of core body temperature also. This particular device has a geometry that's sort of peanut-type shape. That's an antenna that's doing two things. It's harvesting wirelessly delivered power from an antenna that's mounted under the isolate. It's also using that same magnetic inductive link for continuous wireless data transfer as well. And so as a result of those kinds of strategies, you end up with a device that really has the physical characteristics of the epidermis. And you don't need strong tapes to keep it on because you don't have wires pulling on it. And the thin geometry in the low modulus minimizes the interface stresses that would otherwise try to tend to lead to delamination. So that's one device, is electronic device. The other one's optoelectronic, and it's measuring blood oxygenation through full photoplethysmography. So again, full wireless, battery-free, a pair of LEDs, a photodetector, streaming backscattered light intensity back to a data acquisition unit, and you can extract SpO2 from those two measurements. They actually time synchronize. You also get pulse wave velocity, and from that you get arterial stiffness. So actually going beyond clinical standard sets of measurements with these devices. And so we've tested them in about 150 premature babies that have come through Lurie Children's Hospital in the last two and a half years without any adverse events, thereby establishing a tremendous database that sort of validates the technology at a very high level. This is a 31-week-old patient that was consented for these studies. This hand here, that's our Aaron Hombas. He's head of neonatology at Lurie Children's. He was a collaborator on this effort. You can see our device there and then the wire devices there. So we actually expanded now beyond the NICU to the PICU as well. This is the pediatric intensive care unit. It's actually focused on babies who are a little bit older, but they're still requiring full vital signs monitoring. It works very well for them as well. Also, you can see the device on the chest. That's ECG, heart rate variability, respiration rate, and temperature. There's the device on the foot. That's SpO2, blood oxygenation. And so this is the kind of thing that getting rid of the wires really facilitates. They call this kangaroo care, kangaroo mother care. And it turns out to have a very strong therapeutic benefit on the development of the baby, this kind of skin-to-skin contact between mother and child, very powerful. In this case, the antenna is sitting in the base of the chair, delivering power up to these devices and pulling data back off of them as well. So we just published this 1 year ago, and I just want to highlight, you know, if you want to do impactful things in this area, it really has to be highly multidisciplinary. So nearly every field of traditional study and engineering science is embodied in this work, but also medical science as well. So dermatology, neonatology, pediatrics. The nurses turn out to be the most important people, however, because they know what's really going on, what problems really need to be solved, and having their engagement is very powerful and very, very helpful for these studies. So shortly after that paper was published, I had a chance to meet with Bill Gates. He got excited about these technologies and their potential for use in lower and middle income countries where there is no monitoring hardware at all, wireless or wired or otherwise. And so the vision that he had is maybe these countries could leapfrog the wired-based technology just like they leapfrog landlines for phone service and went straight to cell phones. Why not just go straight to wireless platforms, you know, for vital signs monitoring of neonates, maternal fetal monitoring as well. That was a very exciting vision for us, and they provided a large grant along with Save the Children Foundation to deploy into India, Pakistan, Zambia, Kenya, and Ghana. So we're already in Zambia, Kenya, and Ghana. I spent a few weeks in Zambia in December, working very well. Later this year, we'll be into India and Pakistan. But in order to get into those countries, you really have to design the engineering platforms to satisfy the kinds of facilities or align with the kinds of facilities that are available. They have no reliable source of wall power in terms of electricity. So you have to move the power supply onto the devices themselves. So these become battery operated. We published this just a few months ago in March. Of this year, and it turns out we can reproduce everything that we were doing before, but now we don't need that external antenna for power supply or data communication, and we also were able to embed additional functionality. Now we have a platform and a framework that works and is validated. We can begin to insert additional kinds of sensors. So now we're thinking about NICU of the future, and actually NICU of the future is now present in Zambia to a greater extent than it is even here in Chicago. So this is what you know, technology can do. So these are the kinds of things that we're doing in Zambia, for example. We can measure at any given moment. We have a high bandwidth triaxis accelerometer now in the chest unit. So we know exactly at any given moment what the basic body orientation of the baby is. And so we can determine when the baby is engaged, when it's with its mother in this kangaroo mother care type of therapy. And we can see how the vital signs change with the baby when it's engaged with its mother in that way. You look at the SpO2, it pops up. It's almost 100% when the baby is engaged with its mother, and it drops back down when the mother puts the baby back into the isolate. You see the differential between the limb and the chest temperature. It's basically equalized during KMC, and you see a large difference between chest and limb when the baby is left alone. So there's pretty interesting insights that come from that. It's also high enough bandwidth. We actually quantify and measure vocal biomarkers, so cry time, the tonality of crying, the cadence of crying. And so there may be opportunities to apply machine learning to these vocal biomarkers to get a better sense of the health of the baby and kind of what they need at any given moment. And this is the kind of thing that's never been done before. So I think there's tremendous opportunity not only to replicate what's done clinically today, but go way beyond that, you know, into the future to improve the way that these babies are cared for. So currently we're in 17 countries. I mentioned Ghana, Zambia, and Kenya, going into India and Pakistan, many others lined up by the end of the year. It'll be 23. So it's not just the Gates Foundation, Save the Children, but also Anthem, Dräger, BARDA, and other agencies are funding deployment. So that's kind of what we're doing now. There are a number of devices sort of that same flavor in the pipeline designed for other purposes. So flow through shunts and shunted hydrocephalus, pediatric patients, functional NIRS, again, wireless. We're very interested in end of life and beginning of life. So beginning is maternal, fetal, neonatal, pediatric. End of life is Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, stroke survivors. So stroke survivors down here, we have a device that mounts on the suprasternal notch to measure speech and swallowing, because a lot of these stroke survivors have lost the ability to speak or swallow properly. They suffer from aphasia, dysphagia, and they need to undergo rehab. And you'd like to be able to track their speaking and their swallowing in that context. And so let me take a little bit of a detour and tell you a little bit more about that device. It's a unique mounting location. It's a special part on the anatomy. It's a soft tissue location at the base of your neck, right above the point where your collarbones meet. And it's a tremendous location to measure anything associated with respiratory activity. So not only swallow and speech, but also cough and wheezing. You can also pick up sounds associated with the cardiac cycles. And round about March, we were deeply engaged with the stroke patients. We began to get inquiries across from physicians across the medical complex here in Chicago, asking whether we could adapt those devices for measuring the key symptoms associated with COVID-19. Which turn out to be fever, cough, and shortness of breath. It's a respiratory disease. So you want to measure cough, you want to measure shortness of breath. It also involves a fever. This is JAMA. This is April 17th of this year. And so you think about these symptoms, there's a lot of interest in wearables for tracking symptoms of COVID. But if you're on the wrist and or the finger, you're not going to be able to measure cough. You're not going to be able to measure breathing or any kind of respiratory sounds. You can't even get a reliable measurement of body temperature. And so we responded to those inbound requests and basically built out these devices, which were originally designed for stroke patients, for deployment onto COVID patients and frontline healthcare workers here in Chicago. And so we've had about 200 devices out at this point, and we collect data now on a daily basis, and we're able to track very early signs of symptoms for healthcare workers who are at high risk. And so there's the potential for pulling those workers out of the broader community if it looks like they may be developing signs of the disease. They're also on patients, both in the clinic and in the home, so you can monitor the progression of the disease and how they're responding to novel therapeutics and what happens when they go home. Do they get worse or do they get better? Being able to sort of track them at that level. And it's a fully automated system. You put the device on, it automatically collects data onto an onboard memory. You put it onto a charging pad, and it automatically streams the data wirelessly to a cloud server where all the analytics is done. And then there's a graphical user interface for the physician, so they can track all of the nurses, the rehabilitation specialists, all of the patients who are under their supervision. And you really track this stuff, and it's been great success. This is just an example of one patient who very nearly succumbed to the disease. She's a nurse. She only had one lung. She came very close to being admitted into the ICU. But in this case, we were able to start tracking her the day that she was admitted to the hospital, and then 4 weeks after she was released back into the home. So tremendous amount of data. You can see the device right there. And so we have enormous amounts, almost a terabyte worth of data. And so you can begin to tease out sort of insights into the progression of the disease and kind of what's going on in terms of these both conventional, say, heart rate and heart rate variability, respiration rate, but also novel metrics. Nobody's ever tracked coughing before, for example. The patient that I showed you previously, at the peak of her disease, when she was most seriously ill, she was coughing at a rate of about 150 coughs per hour. So tremendous amount of coughing, but you can see the coughing tail away as she begins to get better. So anyway, there's some interesting data here that may lead to deeper insights into the nature of the disease. So with the last 8 minutes that I have here, I'm going to shift gears a little bit and address a question of whether these same skin interface devices can provide any information around biochemical markers of health status instead of coughing or motion or temperature or biopotential or optical measurements. Can we get at the underlying biochemistry associated with disease, health, wellness, that type of thing? And we are interested in doing this, but not with interstitial fluid or blood, because that requires penetration of the skin. There's all kinds of infection risks and pain and all sorts of reasons why you wouldn't necessarily want to do that. And so instead, we gravitated towards sweat because it's a relatively underexplored class of biofluid that has a lot of interesting biochemical species embedded in it. And so the question then became, could you create, say, a microfluidic lab on a chip technology, but not out of glass, not in a chip form, just in the same way that we weren't interested in electronics in a wafer form? Can you use new materials, new mechanics ideas, layout configurations to create that lab on a chip functionality, but in a soft, flexible, skin-like form? And it turns out you can do all of that. You can use soft elastomers and molding approaches to create the microfluidic channels and reservoirs and passive valves and so on. You can use thin elastomeric adhesive layers to create openings that allow eccrine glands to basically pump sweat directly into this microfluidic platform through inlet ports on the backside. And then you can either integrate stretchable electronics with this kind of microfluidics for electrochemical based readout, or you can use colorimetric chemical reagents that respond selectively to particular biomarkers of interest to do it without electronics. And it turns out colorimetrics are very attractive for that reason, and that's what I'll focus on in the next few slides. And so sweat is currently used. It's a clinical gold standard for screening for cystic fibrosis. You look at chloride levels in sweat, and the way it's collected involves sort of a hockey puck rigid type of platform. It's strapped tightly to patients, and you collect a little bit of sweat into a tube. You unfurl the tube and you dump it out into an analytical instrument to get the chloride concentration. Or you use an absorbent pad. It's just taped to the surface of the skin. You peel it off, you wring it out, and you get sweat that way. So that's what's been done in the past. There are a number of really outstanding groups working in this area. Ali Javi's group, Jason Heikenfeld's group, Dae-Hung Kim's group at Seoul National, where they're using electrochemical sensing approaches, and basically sensors interface directly to the skin to sort of measure, you know, different biomarkers in sweat. And I think that's interesting, but it really doesn't leverage the full power of microfluidics. And that's kind of our sweet spot, is really focused on lab on a chip microfluidics to measure not only chemical constituents in sweat, but also measure the actual sweat rate and the sweat volume that's being released from a given point on the body. And so this is the first device we published in 2016. There's a serpentine channel around here leading to a central inlet. And so we can determine from the extent of filling, we have a color change chemistry here, cobalt chloride hydrogel, and it changes in color from purple to red when it comes into contact with water. And so we can just visually determine the fill front. We know the geometry here. So in any given time, we know how much sweat has been lost from that part of the skin, just eyeballing the device. And then we have four separate reservoirs where we have colorimetric chemical reagents for reading out the concentration of lactate, chloride, glucose, and pH, all in one patch with no batteries, no electronics, very low cost, single-use type of system. Now here, as before, the mechanics are super important. It's got to be non-irritating, but also at the same time, it has to support a watertight seal to the skin. It's not easy to do that. So you have to pay a lot of attention to the mechanical properties of the material, select the appropriate polymer-based elastomers, get the layouts of the fluid channels right, and again, use full 3D finite element modeling as a design tool to help guide the material selections and the layouts to accomplish this. So this is what one of these devices looks like, glued or adhered to the outer forearm of graduate students working on the group. You can see in the group at that time, you can see the sweat has filled up that serpentine channel to this point. So I know exactly how much sweat has been lost from that small location on the body. Now it turns out that that local loss of sweat can be calibrated to full body loss with a single calibration factor. So from this local measurement, I know how much sweat this guy has lost in aggregate across the entire body. And then you can either read out by eye the color in those reservoirs, or you can use a digital camera to capture an image, and then you can do color analysis on that image. But this is kind of what it looks like, you know, various stages of filling in the case of a slightly different geometry. This is my skin as I'm working out on elliptical. I'm going through my workout. So you see the sweat start to emerge there. By 6:35, I'm working really hard to see if I can fill the whole thing, and I was able to accomplish that. So there's actually been a lot of sweat loss, but if you look at adjacent regions of the skin, it's not wet. That's because the sweat has been evaporating that whole time. And so that's the whole point. It's very easy to lose track of how much sweat you lost if you don't have a device to provide that information. And that turns out to be very important for an application I'll describe in a second. But in terms of the materials opportunities, I think there are tremendous things to be done in the development of colorimetric chemical reagents for measuring sweat biomarkers. So we have reagents for chloride over a physiologically relevant range. I won't get into the details. Enzymatic colorimetric sensors for glucose. Again, you read it out by color change. You can do lactate, different types of chemistries. You know, pH, very straightforward as well. You can put all of that together, have a multifunctional patch, and with appropriate valving structures, you can create a sort of a sampling approach that gives you not only sort of average chloride concentration given time, but at different time points, because you can build in valves that allows for sequential filling of these analysis reservoirs. And that sequential filling process then gives you an effective sort of time dependence to the kind of information you can get out, again, without any electronics, or just passive molded piece of plastic is what it really is. And so we're mainly interested in medical applications, but if you can identify other sorts of applications, could be very powerful commercial driver for looking at new ways to use sweat in healthcare. And we were able to establish a partnership with Gatorade. They reached out to us. They're very interested in sweat. Their core product is a sports beverage, which is allowing athletes to rehydrate and also replenish lost electrolyte. And so that's what they wanted to measure. We knew how to do that. So we created a device for that purpose. So there's a serpentine channel here that allows an individual who's wearing this device to determine how much sweat they've lost at any given point during a workout or a competition. And then we have a separate channel over here that has that colorimetric chemistry for reading out chloride concentration. So in one device, you get electrolyte loss, sweat loss. That information allows one to determine how much Gatorade to drink and what formulation of Gatorade matches that individual's body chemistry. Everybody has a different electrolyte level in their sweat, and that can change as a function of time and season and dietary habits. So all of that works. It's been extensively field tested on a cohort of athletes, I think 1,200 at this point. Also at the Gatorade Sports Science Institute here in Illinois, they know a lot about sweat. Youth athletes, pro athletes, all the way across the board. It's been featured in commercials involving celebrity athletes. This is Serena Williams. If there are any tennis fans out there, she's probably the greatest women's tennis player of all time. That's our device on her forearm. This is Paul George. If you like basketball, Clippers just got knocked out of the playoffs, but he's a very great, a really great player, power forward. You can see the device there. And so these will be rolled out early next year at unit volumes of about 1 million to start. But ultimately, we're interested in clinical medicine. So we come back to this puck that I told you about before. It's used as a gold standard diagnostic for cystic fibrosis. You measure chloride concentration. We were contacted by pathologists who work in this area at Lurie Children's asking whether we could use our sticker as a replacement for that puck because this leaks. And it's also hard to get the sweat out of the tube and into the external analysis instrument. So it turned out to be a really easy project, really impactful. And we already had the technology completely worked out in the context of our efforts with Gatorade. And so we've done many babies at this point. It's really fun to work with this patient population. You see the device there. This is another guy. And we've been doing one-to-one comparisons. Macroduct is the puck. And our soft sticker. You can see Lightning McQueen there. You put a little graphic on there and the kids love it. And it's really, really fun to do that. And it's as accurate as what's done today, but it's just a lot more patient friendly. So with that, I think I'm out of time. I'm just going to summarize by noting that there are tremendous opportunities for material scientists and materials engineers in this area of bio-integrated systems. And I told you about skin-integrated electronics, skin-integrated microfluidics, but these same ideas apply to many other organs across the body with many other potential applications as well. A very fruitful area, I think, for research in the years to come. So I'll conclude by acknowledging senior collaborators. We're a very interdisciplinary collaborative group. Work with a number of folks in engineering, science, clinical medicine, and sports. Some of the names are listed there. But the most important people are the students. So we run a very large, dynamic group, super smart kids, very hardworking, creative people, undergrads, master's students, MDs, PhDs, postdocs, senior PIs, all the kids with their hands raised are undergrads. And I want to acknowledge also all of their various funding agencies. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor John Rogers, for excellent presentation. Then we have two questions for you here. The Hyunju Lee, then she asked, thank you for the great talk, and it's always inspiring to see how much you have pushed the front of flexible hybrid fabrication for biomedical application. I'm interested to hear about your vision for the next step. What do you think the biggest hurdle we need to overcome to move on to the next phase? Also, one of the ultimate bottlenecks for biointegration might lie on providing power, energy to operate this device. Do you have any insight you could share with us on this front?
Yeah, great question. Thank you for that question. I think tremendous number of different things that require additional work. I think we have a platform that's functional at a certain level. It's satisfying certain requirements, but I don't want to give anybody the impression that all the work is over. You know, it's just starting, because I think once you have a device that kind of works, then it creates tremendous momentum for adding functionality, improving the power supply, the communication range, the memory capabilities, the types and numbers of sensors. I mean, I think it's going to be like a free-for-all because now the floodgates open. So I think power, just so maybe more specifically to your question, power and energy is always a problem. You know, if you look at these devices, especially the ones that we've deployed into Africa, the biggest, heaviest component's the battery. You'll always want a smaller battery, you know, thin and flexible if you can, but you need capacity as well. So there's a balance there. So I think new battery materials, obvious, you know, opportunity. I think, you know, on the other side of it, and there are many other kinds of engineering, you know, efforts that could improve these devices, different aspects of them. But then I think in terms of new sensor development, you know, new kinds of biochemical sensors, I think that's a very powerful frontier area. I think a lot of the physics-based sensors sort of work, and maybe they could be improved, but where there are going to be really enormous opportunities is in the development of approaches that allow chemically specific information is kind of what you want. And maybe there are optical approaches to do that, or maybe, as I was mentioning before, you know, colorimetrics, you get some samples of sweat and you figure out, you know, how does sweat chemistry correlate to blood chemistry? Nobody really knows that. It would be wonderful if there's information there. So I think it's a great area for materials research, and a lot of the hurdles are materials related, you know, at their foundational level. And I think this community can contribute in a very, very important way, where successful outcomes could improve the way we think about healthcare and impact people in that way. And I'm very motivated by that idea, and my students are very energized by it as well.
Thank you for your answer, Professor Rogers. Here is the second question by Togu John. You know him well. Great work. The neonatal, the treatment will be revolutionized by this effort. Could you share us the need and the direction from materials aspect for the improvement of a proposed device? Again, this is a truly the exceptional engineering work for the quality of a human life.
Yeah, I would say there are many. I mean, there are materials aspects of these new sort of biochemical specific sensors that need to be developed. I think also, you know, from the standpoint of the adhesion, I mean, there's a lot of material scientists who are interested in the mechanics of soft adhesions. I think it's a very interesting area for academic research. If there's some kind of switchable adhesive, you know, you could put these devices on, and then, you know, when you need to take them off to clean the baby or something like that, if you could just flip a switch and it would just drop off entirely. We've reduced the adhesive strength, or the requirements for the adhesive strength, by about a factor of 10, but it would be nice to make it go away entirely, you know, the adhesive strength. So I just think there are so many different things to work on. I mentioned batteries, and that's a materials technology as well. You know, you think about skin interfaced electrodes. You want to do ECG. How do you establish that skin electrode interface? I mean, there's a lot of work around carbon nanotubes and composites with elastomers. It's showing very low skin contact impedance. We're just using mesh, kind of open mesh structures of noble metals, but that's kind of primitive. You know, we could do a lot better. You know, I think, you know, materials scientists in the who are listening to this discussion probably have much better ideas than we do. You know, I just think there's so many different things where, you know, this community can contribute at a high level.
Okay, so I want to share the two more questions. Then thank you for introducing the impressive researches. Then I'm Mingyu Lee from the Seoul National University. Biodegradation rate of bioelectronics is an important factor. What is the key factor to control degradation kinetics of bioelectronics?
Degradation kinetics? Let me make sure I understand the question.
Yeah. the control to control the degradation kinetics of bioelectronics?
The devices, the skin integrated devices that I talked about this evening or this morning for you guys, they're not degradable. We are interested in bioresorbable or biodegradable electronics, and the rates are really controlled by the materials themselves and the relative thicknesses of the different material components of a system. So I think in a practical sense, there are two ways to manage the degradation. You really want the devices to operate in a very stable fashion for a well-defined time period and then degrade. So you want this like two-stage degradation, flat, you know, performance characteristics, and then rapid degradation. And so we've approached that problem from the standpoint of using encapsulation layers that don't play any kind of functional role in the electronics, but just serve as barriers to prevent biofluid entry into the active materials. And then as soon as that encapsulating biofluid barrier material has resorbed or dissolved away, at that point, you assume the device is no longer functional because the active materials are now being attacked by surrounding biofluid. So that's kind of the approach that we've taken, and it turns out to work pretty well. The other scheme would be, you know, just to make the active materials thick enough so that even as they're dissolving, you maintain functionality, and it's not until they're completely gone that your device is no longer working. The problem with that is it's really hard to get away from drift in performance, you know, that's affected as the resistance of the interconnecting lines are increasing, as their thickness is decreasing, things like that. So it's all about the encapsulation layer. If you take a look at most biodegradable electronic devices that we're working on anyway, I think the encapsulation layer might be the most significant materials challenge. It seems kind of counterintuitive because it doesn't have to support any kind of high performance electronic functionality, but getting something that is free of pinholes and can maintain integrity as a biofluid barrier over relevant time scales, which is typically a few weeks. If you're thinking about bone healing, it could be 2 months. You know, how you do that turns out to be highly non-trivial. And I think there are probably some materials approaches that could be very helpful, you know, for that goal.
Thank you for your answer. The last question, from a mechanics point of view, the other device designed to sustain the high strains?
We designed them to sustain whatever kind of strains are demanded by the application. So if you look at the human body, the strains are kind of modest. You know, it's maybe up to 20%, maybe, you know, near the elbow, skin of the elbow, maybe it's 50%. But like the heart, it's only about 15% strain, at that level. The brain is even much, much lower than that. So they can be designed to sustain much higher strains, but for biointegration, it's rarely needed. In some cases, you need to accommodate strains in order to, you know, conform to the curve shape, but then once you're in that shape, the strains beyond that, bending-induced strain, are fairly modest. So you don't need 1,000% strain. You'd probably rarely need 100. It's typically around 20. The point at which your skin will start to tear is about 20. So it only stretches by a modest amount. And then beyond that, you're really damaging the underlying tissues. So in that range, 10 to 30% would be kind of typical.
Thanks so much, Professor Rogers, for your great talk and great contribution.